Well-made, but average, is how I would describe the first video I ever uploaded to this channel. It's been 3 years since that day. 3 years since a group of Let's Playing Hyenas infuriated me to the point that my career changed. And it's been a strange, surreal journey. YouTube has given me opportunities that few people get. I've been able to travel across the world, gotten to know some of the kindest and sweetest people I've ever met, and the simple pleasure of making videos is still one of the purest joys I have. But I'd be lying if I said it was all positive. YouTube has also taken me to some of the darkest emotional places I've ever been. I'd say being a YouTuber hasn't been what I expected, but the truth is I never expected anything. For all I knew, my first video was also going to be my last, and the only reason I kept going was because I just really loved making videos. And the response to them has always been secondary to that. And if I'm going to be honest, that response has always been bewildering and a little frightening. I've never really understood why so many people gathered around this channel. I don't even really understand, dear viewer, why you've taken time out of your day to watch this. But one thing that hasn't changed is I still love Hunter x Hunter. It's still one of my three favorite shows ever, right alongside Yu Yu Hakusho and one other I hope I one day have the courage to do a full video on. And if anything, Hunter x Hunter means more to me now than even when I first made that video, and a big part of that is how changes in my life have recontextualized what its story means to me. And when I go back and look at that original video now, what strikes me is just how much I didn't say. Take for example a character like Killua. He's one of my favorite characters in any medium, and yet in that original video, I barely glanced off him. I never talked about how much it meant to me to see this strong, cool, charismatic character struggle with anxiety the same way I did when I first watched the show, and what a comfort that was. Or what a subtle but sincere show of respect and love it is that he refers to his little sister Alika as she, when the rest of the Zoldyck family only acknowledge her as he. Killua is sweet and playful and charming, which is also why it's such a shock when in rare moments, Hunter x Hunter reminds us that he is at his core a vicious, cold killer. There's a duality to Killua that I love. He's a character capable of touching empathy but also chilling malice. He feels like what he is, a good person raised to do awful things, a facet of himself intrinsically bound to him by his family and upbringing, raised only as a taker of human life without compassion or warmth. But it's in Gon he finds that warmth. Unlike Leorio, Karapika, or Gon himself, Killua doesn't have any long-term goal. His goal is to just stay by Gon's side and help him however he can, and it's the relationship that forms between these two that is the emotional core of Hunter x Hunter. Gon and Killua aren't rivals. They have no interest in surpassing one another or proving who is stronger. They're just friends that wants what's best for the other, and share a tenderness and affection I don't think you really see a lot in shonen. And that's part of the reason why the journey they take is so compelling. The other part being the world they journey through. Hunter x Hunter's story stays focused on Gon and Killua for the early part of the series, and it gives ample time for a bond to form between the two and for the audience to become invested in it. But then, around episode 40, something amazing happens, at the advent of the York New City arc. Now, the focus of Hunter x Hunter's story pulls right back, and suddenly it's not just about Gon and Killua anymore, but about everybody, and we watch as our two protagonists become just a small part of a much greater whole, with dozens of new characters introduced, many of whom have their own individual relationships and connections to one another. And Hunter x Hunter's world opens up. Two of my favorite worlds in anime are Hunter x Hunter and One Piece, and I think the reason they're both successful as worlds is similar. They are both dense with believable, well-written characters that serve as the different moving parts that make up the chaotic whole of each's universe. But what separates the two is scale. One Piece feels vast and infinite, comprised of dozens of factions made up of hundreds of characters that all move through the world with their own logic and drives. And it gives One Piece a gargantuan sense of scale that's taken decades to build up, but it allows for arcs of massive scope, like the Great Summit War of Marineford. While on the other hand, Hunter x Hunter is a much smaller and more intimate scope with far fewer factions and characters, but in turn allows each character to proportionally be a much bigger part of the story. I should note that that's not a criticism of either series, rather I'm just highlighting the individual strengths of each. What I enjoy about the more intimate world of Hunter x Hunter is we get to experience not just a character's background and history, but how that journey has shaped them and thus the effect they have on the wider story. Take a character as minor as Melody, a music hunter whose body was deformed after hearing part of a cursed song, played by her friend who lost his life in the process, and she now searches for the scripture that contains the other parts of that song in order to destroy them so that no one can ever suffer the same fate that she has. Other people's well-being is important to Melody, which is the motive that leads her from stopping Kurapika from entering a battle with the Phantom Troop they likely would not have been able to win at this point, which results in Kurapika regrouping and later taking a more tactical approach with the same enemy, which in turn would have much larger scale reverberations in the arc as a whole. This is the beauty of the York New City arc. It's not driven by any overarching plot structure or adherence to convention, but by dozens of minor but logical decisions from well-defined characters that domino throughout the arc in unpredictable and disastrous ways. No character feels insignificant, no choices without consequence, and just like Gon and Killua, these characters are all in pursuit of their own goals on their own journeys, the paths of which lead to them crashing into one another. And it's messy and chaotic and brutal. People get hurt and lives get broken. In much the same way life is. We are a planet of 7 billion people all pursuing our own ends and occasionally destroying each other in the process. And the beauty of the York New City arc is that it captures that feeling. The story does return focus to Gon and Killua periodically in the arcs that would follow, but that feeling never leaves. There's always the sense that these two are only a small part of a greater world and vulnerable to the more powerful forces in it. Even the rule set of the world itself is constantly swimming and changing. The first set of rules are the guidelines to the Hunter exam, with us then in Heaven's Arena being introduced to the principles of the Nen system, which would govern every battle from that point on, only to then have that system heavily modified with the gameplay mechanics of Greed Islands and evolved even further in Hunter x Hunter's most recent arc with the introduction of Nen beasts. Which, if you are unfamiliar, Nen beasts are like JoJo stands if they had their own agency, whose abilities are defined by the characteristics of its user, and can even evolve dependent on that user's emotional state and well-being, with each Nen beast tied to one of 14 princes, all participating in a massive game of death as they vie for control of their father's throne. And that is only a small fraction of the different forces at play. This arc is insane, feeling totally different from anything that's come before, and while it is very dense and does occasionally slam the reader with walls and walls of text, the fact that Togashi is so willing to change up the rule set of each arc of Hunter x Hunter is to me a big part of why this journey is still so exciting. The real insanity, though, is that the entire Succession War arc is likely just a setup for a much bigger story to come. Towards the end point of Hunter x Hunter's anime, it's revealed that everything that happened so far has all taken place on a small collection of island nations, encompassed by a vast sea, on the horizon of which lies a colossal forbidden land known only as the Dark Continent, any voyage to which has either been unsuccessful, or for the few that returned, brought a great and terrible calamity to the human race. And the entire Succession War arc I just talked about is all taking place on a giant vessel holding all our characters and factions on a voyage to the Dark Continent. And the thought of what could be waiting there or even who is going to survive to see it is so exciting, but also serves as something vital for Hunter x Hunter, a new horizon for these characters. And I think the fact that Togashi has managed to recapture that sense of wonder so late in the series' run is incredible. And also, what I kind of love about this series. You have all these different characters, divided by their individual goals and motivations, but driven by the same desire to move forward, even if it's towards something potentially horrific and terrible. Journeys rarely conclude how characters expect in Hunter x Hunter. Sometimes the revenge you spent your whole life trying to achieve ends up being just as hollow as you feared it would be. Maybe the father figure you've spent years pursuing turns out to be more concerned with his own journey than he ever was with you. Or maybe the person you put all your hope into and just wish to stay beside ends up being just as capable of evil as the family you ran away from. Life's hard in Hunter x Hunter. Things waiting at the end of those journeys are rarely what our characters hope for. And it can be cruel and painful, injecting a palpable sense of strife into this world of hope and wonder. And for me, this is always what's kept me invested in Togashi's work, that genuine sense of strife he imbues into the conventions of shonen storytelling. And I think the reason that pain feels so real is because it is. I talked about this a lot in my Yu Yu Hakusho video, but he's never made a secret of the physical and mental anguish creating manga has caused him, and particularly in the brutally honest final author's note of that series, in which he details the schedule he had to maintain and the effects it had on his physical and mental health, ending with the heartbreaking sentence, "I ended Yu Yu Hakusho because of my own selfishness. I'm sorry." Those words have haunted me over the years. I've always felt conflicted that one of the series that has brought me the most joy also caused its author such hardship. And I bring this up because one of the many things I was not expecting when I uploaded that first video was how the experience would eventually give me a little more insight into what Togashi may have felt. I know what it's like to be in a position that many people would kill for. I know what it's like to have your work enjoyed by hundreds of thousands of people across the world. And I know the deep wells of resentment and self-loathing that come with the feeling that you are constantly letting that audience down. I can't help think of how excited Togashi must have been to see his manga first published, and how differently he would have felt by the end. But in a way, I think that experience is what led to Hunter x Hunter. Hunter x Hunter is a series where things constantly go wrong, but it never really seems to matter because what matters is that the characters took that initial step in the first place, no matter how badly it all ends. And endings is something I've been thinking about a lot lately. I get asked a lot about the future of this channel and if I'd ever consider ending it, and the truth is, I don't know. I don't know where any of this is going. I have as much of a plan now as I did when I uploaded that first video, and if I'm gonna be really honest, I'm more tired and emotionally exhausted writing this than maybe I've ever been. My personal relationships have suffered, as has my output and general well-being, and I don't know how much longer I can keep doing this. But what I do know is that no matter how it all ends, I am so glad I posted that first video. I am so thankful for the journey that has brought me to this moment, which is why I think it's so important to find what makes you happy and pursue it with everything you have. And things will go wrong, things will not work out like you expect, but it won't matter because people need a pursuit. People need a purpose. And that to me has always been the message at the heart of this brilliant, beautiful series, which is why I'm so glad I started doing this, and why you should still watch Hunter x Hunter. Friends, thank you for watching my video and for everything else. I'm going to be taking a little time away from making videos just until I get some proper rest in me and figure some stuff out. But in the meantime, if you want to support me, you can head on over to patreon.com/super eyepatchwolf. And I just want to take a moment and thank everyone who has already done so and made this entire thing possible. If you haven't seen, I'm going to be at MAGFest, so if you see me there, feel free to say hello, and I promise I will not be as much of a bummer as I have been this video. You can also find me on the Let's Fight a Boss video game podcast or on Twitter at eyepatchwolf. And hey, I also occasionally do streams on Twitch now. Friends, thank you for sticking with me this far. Take care of yourselves, and I'll see you next year.